This presentation is brought to you by Arizona State University's Julianne Wrigley Global Institute of Sustainability and a generous investment by Julianne Wrigley.
So the book Merchants of Doubt examines the history of what Eric Conway and I called doubt mongering. That is to say, using scientific uncertainty as a political tool, a strategy to create doubt about the reality and severity, not just of climate change, but of a whole set of issues involving public safety, public health, and environmental issues. And in our book, we focused particularly on one group of people that we had become interested in because it was a group of very prominent scientists who had been involved since the late 1980s in doubt mongering campaigns related to climate change, acid rain, the ozone hole, and some other things. And so part of what we tried to do in the book was to trace this campaign back to its origins in this place, the George C. Marshall Institute, and this group of Cold War physicists, but then also to show how and why their message had spread, and how it spread through a network of think tanks and organizations in the United States, some of whom are listed there on the right, and also to explain the political ideology behind it, to explain the motivation to challenge scientific evidence rooted in the political economic philosophy of laissez-faire capitalism, and the idea or the desire to prevent government intervention in the marketplace. So that's a nutshell kind of encapsulation of the book. So now you don't have to read it. No, you should still read it, but in any event. But one of the things that was interesting to me when the book came out and it got reviewed was that a lot of people who talked about the book had obviously not read it because they said it was a book about the fossil fuel industry. And actually, the book's really not about the fossil fuel industry at all. I mean, the fossil fuel industry is sort of in the background of our story, but it really was not the principal focus. Because the important thing that we thought we had discovered in our research, the thing we thought people needed to understand, was that actually the roots of this story are not found in the fossil fuel industry, they're found in the tobacco industry. And in fact, there is a direct connection between climate change denial and the denial of the harms of tobacco in the actual person of this man, Frederick Seitz, who was the founding director of the George C. Marshall Institute, but also worked for 6 years as the director of biomedical research for the R.J. Reynolds Tobacco Company. And what Seitz did in those 6 years that he spent with R.J. Reynolds was to promote what we've called confounding research. That is to say, to support scientific research, real research, I mean, it was research done by scientists, but whose purpose was not to clarify the role of tobacco in public health, but to confuse it, to distract attention away from the scientific evidence of the harms of tobacco by calling attention to other issues, such as other causes of cancer. So, of course, as we all know, there are many causes of cancer. Tobacco smoking is by no means the only cause of lung cancer. So by focusing attention on asbestos or radon or stress or prions or all kinds of other things to distract attention from the role of tobacco. And obviously, it was a very clever strategy, in part because many scientists accepted the funding from the tobacco industry because it was, in fact, funding for legitimate scientific research. So that piece of the story alone actually raises a lot of really interesting questions for universities about the ethics and politics of accepting funding from an industry like the tobacco industry, even if the funding is for legitimate and genuine scientific research, which this was. Now, one of the reasons this story is important is because the tobacco industry was ultimately found guilty of conspiracy to commit fraud for these activities. So in the case of the United States of America et al. Versus the Philip Morris USA et al. And the total list of people, it's not just Philip Morris, it's R.J. Reynolds and many other tobacco companies, the tobacco industry was found responsible for criminal conspiracy under the RICO statutes. This is the statutes that the federal government uses to prosecute organized crime. They were found responsible for creating an enterprise for purposes of committing fraud, and they were found to have falsely denied, distorted, and minimized the significant adverse health consequences of smoking for decades. So a key part of this indictment was the denial, distortion, and minimization of scientific evidence. Because after all, the evidence for the adverse health consequences of smoking came from science. So a very significant part of this case, probably the most important part of this case, involved the misrepresentation of scientific evidence. So I thought, as a historian of science, well, it's good news for us, right? Because it shows that the question of what science says, what scientists have to say, what scientific evidence tells us, is not just a scientific question. It's a cultural question, it's a social question, and in this case, it became a legal question as well. Now, part of the, again, part of the finding on the part of Judge Kessler, who ruled in this case, was that the defendants, that is to say the tobacco industry, have marketed and sold their lethal product with zeal, with deception, with a single-minded focus on their financial success, and without regard for the human tragedy or social cost that that success exacted. And I thought that was a very interesting thing for the judge to have said, because if you think about it, doing business without regard for social costs is not necessarily illegal. It may be illegal, but it may not be. There are many things that businesses do that have social costs that are not illegal. But the judge is saying here, these people broke the law, but it's not just that they broke the law. The offense here is both the fact that they broke the law and that they did this with this kind of reckless disregard for human tragedy, for the millions of deaths that were caused by people who smoked cigarettes. So, because our book traced the history of climate change denial back to the tobacco industry, there are some obvious analogies and parallels that it seemed to me were worth exploring in more detail. And I would argue that in recent years, the social costs of fossil fuel use have become increasingly clear. So if you drive a car, heat your home, air condition, do any of the myriad things that we all do when we use fossil fuels, we're not breaking the law, but we are doing something that has social costs. And these social costs have become increasingly clear.
This presentation is brought to you by Arizona State University's Julianne Wrigley Global Institute of Sustainability for educational and non-commercial use only.